In this video, I'm going to show you how to install Kali Linux within VirtualBox on a Windows 11 computer. There are various ways to get Kali Linux up and running. You could use dual booting, where you boot between Windows and Kali. You could use a USB flash drive. Various options. I've shown you those in previous videos, which I've linked below. In this example, I've got three virtual machines running Kali Linux on this Windows computer. I've got it running within VMware Workstation Player, and I've got two images running within VirtualBox. The reason I've done this is during the recording of this video, I had issues with the image that I downloaded from the Kali website. So I'll show you how to get around those issues by showing you how to import the virtual machine as well as install it using an ISO image. My Windows installation picked up the latest release of Kali that I downloaded as containing a virus, so I had to install it using an ISO. But I'll show you both methods in this video. You may prefer to use VMware. In the past, I preferred VMware, but I found that VMware has issues and is limited in some ways. As an example, you can't use snapshots with VMware Workstation Player, but you get snapshots with VirtualBox. In this video, I'm covering a whole bunch of things, including how to enable VTX in the BIOS of an Intel laptop, as well as AMDV in the BIOS of an AMD laptop. I, as I mentioned, encountered various issues during the installation. I didn't want to take out some of the problems because you may encounter those same issues that I did. I've left a whole bunch of options in this video, but use the timestamps to jump to the various parts. As an example, if you simply want to install Kali using an ISO image, use this timestamp. Hopefully, I've covered a whole bunch of options that will help you get this working on your computer. I'm often asked which is the best way to run Kali Linux. And as is true with a lot of things in life, it really depends. Depends on you, depends on what options you want. You can run Kali using WSL. There are disadvantages and advantages to using WSL. You could use VMware Player. You could use VirtualBox. Advantages and disadvantages to both. And as I often like to say, if you're unsure, try different options and see which works best for you. As a starting point, however, look at using VirtualBox on a Windows computer, using this within a virtual machine, because that's going to be one of the easiest ways to get up and running. VirtualBox is free, so there's no cost to using it. Kali Linux is available for free, so there's nothing stopping you getting this up and running. This is what's called a Type 2 hypervisor. In other words, we are running a hypervisor on a host operating system. The host operating system in this example is Windows. The guest operating systems are these Kali Linux virtual machines running within Windows. So we've got our hardware, which is our laptop. On top of that, we've installed Windows, our host operating system, and then we've installed a hypervisor, which in this case is VirtualBox. And then we are running virtual machines within the hypervisor. This once again is one of the easiest ways to get started, allows you to start learning Linux, allows you to start learning hacking and other technologies without having to reinstall your computer. I've said enough now, let me show you how to get this installed and up and running. Now, before you install Kali Linux, one of the first things you want to do is make sure that VTX is enabled on your Intel laptop or AMDV is enabled on your AMD laptop. So on the Windows taskbar, I'm going to go to Task Manager. I'm going to go to Performance. I'm going to select CPU, and I'm going to make sure that virtualization is enabled. You need to have this option enabled. If it's not enabled, I'm going to show you how to enable VTX in the BIOS right now. If it's already enabled on your laptop, then jump to this timestamp where I show you how to download VirtualBox Kali Linux and get it installed and running. Okay, so if it's not installed, what you want to do is shut down your laptop. So when your laptop boots up, you need to use the special hotkey to get it to boot into BIOS. So in this case, it's a Dell laptop, so it was F12. On an Asus laptop, as an example, it would be F2. You just need to use the special hotkey to boot into BIOS. If you're not sure which key to use, have a look on the internet for your specific laptop. The BIOS of laptops varies. But for this specific laptop, I'm going to go to BIOS Setup. I'm going to go to Virtualization, and I'm going to make sure that Intel Virtualization Technology, or VTX, is enabled. That's actually being enabled on this laptop, but if yours is not enabled, then enable that, apply your changes, and then exit out of the laptop and boot back into Windows. I've actually got Kali Linux dual booting with Windows on this laptop, hence me having a Kali Linux boot window, which I then use to boot into Windows. You obviously won't have that if you've just got Windows installed. But that's an example of how to boot into the BIOS on an Intel computer. So on this Asus laptop, I've pressed F2 to go into the BIOS of the Asus laptop. I'm going to go to the advanced mode in BIOS and then go to advanced here. And what you'll notice is SVM mode is enabled in the BIOS of this computer. That's very similar to AMDV or VTX on an Intel computer. So make sure that AMDV is enabled, or in this case, SVM mode, and then save your changes and exit out of BIOS. So I'll save those changes and exit and boot back into Windows. And now I'll be able to install Kali on this Asus laptop running with an AMD processor. One of the things you're going to want to make sure is that your computer meets the minimum requirements to run Kali Linux. It depends on what you want to install. But for this example, we're going to opt for the default desktop and the Kali Linux default packages. You really need at least 2 gig of RAM and 20 gig of disk space. I'll show you when we download the Kali virtual machine, the actual settings that come with it. For example, 2 gig of RAM, 4 CPU cores, and 80 gig of disk space. The moral of the story is more is better. So 2 gig of RAM is a minimum, but I'd probably want to at least run with 4 gig of RAM. You want to give it 80 gig of disk space as an example. You're going to want to give it as many cores as your computer supports. Okay, first thing we need to download is VirtualBox. So you can get that by going to virtualbox.org. I've put a link below this video. Scroll down and click on Download VirtualBox 7.0. That's the version at the time of this recording. If there's a later release when you watch this video, then download that release. VirtualBox is available for various platforms, Windows, macOS, Linux, and others. But for this example, I want to download VirtualBox for Windows. So I'm going to save that to my computer. While I'm here, I'm going to download 7-Zip. You can go to the URL 7-zip.org or use the link that I've put below. I'm going to download the executable for Windows 64-bit and click Save. And then I'm going to go to Kali.org and download Kali Linux. This is quite a big download, so you probably want to get this downloaded while you're doing other things, depending on your internet connection. So Kali.org, click on download. In this example, we're going to download a virtual machine. So click on virtual machine. I'm using 64-bit, hence the requirement to have VTX or AMDV enabled in the BIOS of the computer. And for this example, I'm going to download VirtualBox. We're told that it's 2.6 gig in size. So I'm going to click download to download that file. It's busy downloading. According to this, it'd take about 6 minutes. The version that's downloading is 2023.3, about 4 minutes left. I've actually pre-downloaded a version of Kali, just changed in the last few days at the time of this recording, so I've got 2023.2. It's the same process, however. Okay, so we need to install the software. First thing we need to do is install VirtualBox. So I'll double-click on the executable. Windows complains, but I'm going to install this anyway. As always, you use software at your own risk. But this is very reputable software, so I wouldn't worry too much about VirtualBox. I'm going to say yes to install it. It's a very simple installation. I'm going to basically just go with the defaults. So I'm going to click Next. I'm not going to customize the installation. Click Next. We're told that network interfaces will be created. So if you see new virtual interfaces, that's normal. So if I go to Control Panel, Network and Internet, Network and Sharing Center, change my adapter settings. You'll notice at the moment that I have an Ethernet connection. That's how I've connected to the Internet. I'm physically downloading files using a wired connection. I've got a wireless connection and some VMware connections. What will happen now is when we install VirtualBox, we'll see VirtualBox interfaces added to the computer. That's normal. So I'm going to click Yes. We're told that they're missing dependencies. So I'm going to install those and I'm going to click Install. And as you can see, VirtualBox is now installing. What you'll notice now is we have a VirtualBox Ethernet adapter. So again, that's normal. And then I'll click Finish to start a VirtualBox. Okay, so there you go. I've got VirtualBox installed. What I want to do, however, is I want to go back to VirtualBox and I want to download the extension pack. This supports, for example, RDP, disk encryption, and some other options, which you can read about on the VirtualBox website. I'm going to click on the All Supported Platforms link and click Save to download that. Double click on the extension pack installation file. Now, I've previously installed this, so I'm going to reinstall it. You obviously will click install to install the software. You need to scroll down through the license agreement. And if you agree, obviously read it and then click agree and then say yes to install the software. That's now installed. So my extension pack is installed and VirtualBox is installed. Okay, so let's have a look at the Kali installation. Has that downloaded? Now the Kali installations use 7Z software or 7-Zip software. So what we need to do is install 7-Zip. So I'm going to double click on the 7-Zip installer and click install anyway. say yes to install it, and then I'm going to click install to install 7-zip and click close. That'll allow me to extract the Kali 7z file and then import it into VirtualBox. Okay, so this is something interesting. My antivirus on my Windows computer has detected that there's a virus in that Kali Linux VirtualBox installation. It didn't pick this up in the old version, but it's picking it up in the new version. So what I'll do for this example is use my previously downloaded version of Kali 2023.2. If you want to, you could use the installer image. So rather than downloading a virtual machine, you could try downloading using the ISO rather than a pre-built virtual machine. The thing with Kali is it's running tools that Windows may determine is a virus or is a malware. Okay, so here's the 7z file. If it downloaded without any issues, you would simply do this on the version that you downloaded. I'm going to click show more options, select 7-zip, and I'm going to extract the file to a subfolder. Okay, so that's being extracted. You can see my VirtualBox folder here. What I can do in VirtualBox, obviously you'd need to wait for that to extract, is click add. I'm going to go to my downloads folder, click VirtualBox and select the file that was extracted and click open. And there you go. My Kali virtual machine is imported into VirtualBox. Before I run it, however, I'm going to click on settings to check the settings. I suggest you do this to make sure that it's compatible with your computer. So as an example, under system, it's been allocated 2 GB of RAM. Under processor, it's been allocated 2 cores. Under storage, the Kali virtual machine has been allocated 80 gigs of space. So just make sure that, for instance, you adjust the CPU. So I could, as an example, give this 4 cores. I could increase the memory to 498 to make it faster and click OK. Simply set those settings to the correct settings for your laptop and then click start. And hopefully this will boot up without any problems. Okay, so you can see VirtualBox has started and Kali Linux will boot up. And there you go. I've got Kali running on my computer. Default username is Kali, password is Kali, and I can log in. And there you go. I could resize this, move it around, and make changes. Now, one thing on this virtual machine settings has got this by default using NAT, which might be okay. You might be happy to use NAT. So I could ping google.com as an example using this virtual machine, and that works. This once again is like running a computer within your computer. So all the settings apply. So I could, as an example, shut this down. If you want to connect to that virtual machine from your local computer, what you want to do is go to settings, go to network, and you want to change this to bridged. Just be aware that doing that exposes Kali to your local network and someone else could get access to this computer. And Kali as a hacking platform isn't necessarily what you want to expose to your local network. But if you did this within your home network, as an example, and wanted to give yourself access to your local Kali virtual machine, you could do this. So it's booting up. And there you go. I could log in once again. And what I'll do here is use the command IP address to see my local IP address. You can see it's got this IP address 192.168.0.114. On my Windows computer, I'll open up a command prompt, ipconfig. This has got this IP address 192.168.0.166. So what I'll do is ping 192.168.0.114. So there you go, I could ping the Kali virtual machine from my Windows computer, and then I could do other things, for instance, enable SSH and SSH to the Kali virtual machine. Okay, so there you go, I've got Kali Linux working within Windows 11 by downloading the virtual machine from the Kali virtual website. But what you could do is go to machine, new virtual machine, and create a new Kali virtual machine. So I'll just say Kali ISO, because I'm creating this from an ISO image, and the ISO image that I'll select is the one that I downloaded, and I'll click next. Give it the amount of RAM that you want, so 4096, number of CPUs, let's say 4, click next. How big do you want the disk space to be? So I'll set it the same as the Kali virtual machine, click next. and click finish. So I've got the Kali virtual machine running off of the image that I downloaded from the website. And here I could start up my ISO image and install Kali this way. It's going to take more work because I'll have to go through the installation process, but that's not very difficult. So what I'll select is graphical install. Okay, my language is English. You could specify your location, let's say United Kingdom or United States. So in my case, it's UK, so I'll select that. Keyboard that I'm using is British, and you could just specify the keyboard that you want to configure. So I'll select British English keyboard. Okay, network has been discovered. We're now asked to configure our host name. I'll just go with the default Kali. I'm not going to specify a domain. We need to specify a user. I'm just going to go with Kali. And the password, this is obviously not a great password, but I'll just use Kali, similar to what we have with the virtual machine when that's downloaded. And I'll click continue. I'm going to use the entire disk. Click continue. Continue again. So I'm going to finish the partitioning and write changes to the disk and click continue. I'm okay with these changes being made. So say yes and continue. And as you can see, the base system is installed. Okay, now you need to choose the software that you want to install. I'm going to go with the defaults and click continue. So the software is now being unpacked and installed. So this is a good time to go and get a coffee. It's going to take a while to install. Okay, so we asked if we want to install the Grub bootloader. The answer is yes. So I'm going to click continue. I'm going to specify the hard drive and then click continue. The installation is now being finished. Okay, and there you go. We're told that the installation is complete. We're told to make sure that we remove the installation media. So I'll go to machine settings, storage. And we can see that the ISO DVD image is no longer connected. So that's good. So I'm going to click continue. And there you go. The virtual machine is now rebooting. And Kali Linux has now booted up. I'll log in. And there you go. I can resize it. It's currently using network address translation, so you could change that to bridged if you want to have the virtual machine on your local segment. But I can still connect to the internet using NAT if I want to. And there you go, I can get to the Kali website. So in this example, I've now got Kali running from the VirtualBox image that I downloaded, as well as from an ISO. The Kali virtual machine from ISO is available in Documents, Virtual Machines, Kali Linux. You can see the amount of space that it's using is about 5 gig. The extracted VirtualBox image is still in my downloads directory. You might want to move that somewhere else. This isn't really a great place to have it, but you can see that this is using about 13 gig of space. Okay, so I hope you enjoyed this video. I showed you a whole bunch of options, how to get around various issues. If you enjoyed this video, please consider subscribing to my YouTube channel. I cover a whole bunch of technologies on my YouTube channel and show you how to set up Kali Linux in various ways, as well as interview a lot of cybersecurity experts. I'm David Bumble, and I want to wish you all the very best.